Hello, ho, ho, everyone, and happy holidays, no matter what you celebrate or don't. Everyone is okay, but Josh had some unexpected health issues this week, landing him in the hospital for a couple of days, but he is home now and doing great. Because of that, we're taking the holiday week off and getting some much-needed rest. Before we share our second episode of Deduce from Patreon, we wanted to update you on the Wilma Acosta case. Wilma has been missing since the early morning hours of November 26th after a night out with friends. First of all, everyone supporting the search for Wilma has been amazing. The petition at change.org urging the Portland police to investigate her case properly is up to 1,418 signatures of 1,500, so let's get that to the goal, like, today. The Facebook group Searching for Wilma Acosta has over 1,000 members. The GoFundMe is up to $4,865 of $5,000. As we spoke with Wilma, Wilma's mother of the same name, she wanted to refuse to create a GoFundMe or Venmo because she does not want money. She wants Wilma. But she was reminded that the money is for flyers, rewards, a private investigator, legal support, and all of the unexpected costs they have incurred. So please keep giving. As soon as we know the Venmo or Cash App information, we will share it. Wilma's family has joined forces with the United Justice Group, the group put together by the families of the victims of the alleged serial killer earlier this year. They have been incredible, standing with Wilma's family to bring attention to their case and provide all of the support they can. They know exactly how it feels to not only be thrown into this kind of scenario, not knowing what to do, but to have also had the police dismiss their cases. United Justice Group was able to get their contact from KPTV, our local Fox outlet, to meet outside City Hall the other day to allow the family to speak about their frustrations. Here, have a listen.
So it has been nearly a month since 28-year-old Wilma Acosta went missing after leaving a bar late at night in Old Town. Well, now Acosta's family is connecting with the families of five women who were found dead around the metro area this year to find comfort in this uncertain time and keep spirits high during their efforts to find her. Fox 12's Connor McCarthy spoke with the family today. He joins us live at Tomacall Park, where Acosta was last seen.
Well, Riel, here at the Japanese American Historical Plaza is where Wilma Acosta's phone last pinged, and since then, she has not been found. Now, Portland police say that Acosta had a history of depression and suicidal ideations, but her family says strongly that is not true. Now, Acosta's family is getting help from families here in the Portland area who had a similar experience earlier this year. All around Governor Tom McCall Waterfront Park near Old Town, missing person posters hang on light posts and trees with the name and face of 28-year-old Wilma Acosta. It was at the Japanese American Historical Plaza where her phone was found, but Acosta could not be located.
She was very happy. She just bought a Dalmatian dog. She got the car that she wanted, a Jeep. She had appointments to go on vacation in 2 weeks.
Nearly a month after Wilma went missing, family and friends gathered outside of City Hall, demanding Portland police do more to find her.
I'm not anti-police, I'm pro-police. I back the blue. I'm nothing against that. It's just the women out here, my sister, there needs to be more help out here.
Wilma's brother, Michael Lopez, says he would have never thought he and his family would be in this situation, looking for a sister who just moved to Portland from San Jose, California, to work at Kaiser Permanente.
It feels like, I guess, anyone could be in this situation. You're never going to know when to expect it or see it.
Wilma was last seen right after Thanksgiving, leaving Dixie's Tavern shortly after 2 a.m. Portland police say the video shows her walking up to the seawall along the Willamette River. They believe she had suicidal ideations and depression, which they noted in their initial media release, something Lopez says his family strongly disputes.
Someone stopped her from point A to point B. She was on her way home. Someone stopped her from point A to B. I know that. You know, it's just getting the proof of that. Or let's just say they were accurate, right? And they said they went in there. Where's the dive team? I don't see no dive team, but they never even went in there to go search.
To help find answers, Wilma's family reached out to the United Justice Group, a group created by the families of the five women who went missing, then found dead around the metro area this year.
We know we can only do so much to help, but whatever that is, We're going to fight right alongside this family, and we will be heard.
For Melissa Smith, Kristen Smith's mother, meeting Wilma's family Friday was even more important because it's the one-year anniversary of when she filed a missing persons report for her daughter.
We have a person of interest in our case for these girls, and I have made it known I'm not giving up. I will not give up, and I will fight till my death for justice for my daughter. And if I have to come out here and help these other families and be heard, so be it. We're doing it. We're not giving up, but we need help.
Portland police sent Fox 12 a statement that reads in part, quote, the Portland Police Bureau's missing persons unit has been dogged in its approach to determining what happened to Wilma. Our detectives have spent more than 100 hours interviewing witnesses and examining footage for more than a dozen security cameras. During her walk, it does not appear that Wilma engaged with any other people. Ultimately, PPB's evidence shows Wilma leaving the bar herself and arriving at the seawall by herself. PPB detectives do not suspect foul play in Wilma's disappearance. We hope Wilma's family and friends are able to find closure soon. Wilma's family says there's more to her disappearance, and they won't give up until they get answers.
It seems like we're just left in the dark and not getting no answers, and we need help. We need the voices to be heard for all these women. On top of my sister, like, I feel she's not getting no attention, no help. My stomach is twisting, turning, like having nightmares because I don't know what else to do. Besides what we're doing, just try to get the word out.
The only change to that interview that Mike, Wilma's brother, said that he would have made is that he doesn't even want the mention of suicide, medication, or hospitalization to happen. There continues to be no sign of Wilma struggling in that way whatsoever. It appears to be a catch-all to allow the police to not investigate. As I mentioned in the update last week, last Saturday, the family did have two boats taken out on the Willamette River, near where the phone had been recovered. The experts aboard both boats felt that they had found a shape worth investigating closer, meaning with divers. The family gave the police this information, so the next day, last Sunday, they did take boats out and claimed to find only logs, and no divers were put in the water. Because the family has been left to their own devices, it took until this last Saturday, the 23rd, to get divers out on the water. Amazingly, the team from Oregon Rescue Divers offered their help. They are based out of Bend and were actually coming from Idaho, where they had just helped with a dive. And even though they spent their entire morning unexpectedly at Les Schwab replacing their blown tires on the boat trailer, they still came all the way to Portland and got on the water. They went over that same space of water near where the phone had been found and where the shape had been. It was like a fine-toothed comb. They just went up and down the water over and over again. Because it had been a week, the shape was not found. They did continue upriver in case whatever it was had drifted, but I did not hear of anything being located. This is another example of contradictions within the police. If they are so certain that Wilma took her own life by leaping into the water off of the bridge, wouldn't they still want to send a team to recover her? Why does it take the family showing signs of a body to get them out on the water? If you can, please go to OregonRescueDivers.org and donate. Their help has been so appreciated by Wilma's family, and they asked that their information be shared along with the gratitude they have for the help. Supposedly, Wilma's mother will be able to view the footage from the steel bridge that the police are finally in custody of. The meeting has been canceled several times already, so she is hoping that they will stick to the Wednesday morning viewing. We will keep you posted on the Facebook group if the family would like support for this. I think that if a group of supporters were with Wilma as she goes to the appointment, perhaps they would be less likely to cancel. We don't know if that footage will show Wilma taking her life, being taken by others, or showing that the footage is not clear and what happened at the bridge is unknown. But hopefully the family will have some answers after Wednesday. As for now, that's the update. As I said, please follow the Facebook group. If you aren't in town or you aren't comfortable coming out for vigils or searches, share her flyer, sign the petition, give if you can. This is a family that had plans to drive Wilma's piano up from California for Christmas, not spend it in her apartment, wanting nothing more than her safe return. Thank you again, you guys. This family is so beautiful, and on a personal note, they have been nothing but warm and welcoming to me. Their strength, love, and patience is truly inspiring. As Wilma has taught me, I will keep looking out for human kindness. There's a lot more of it than I realized, but she seems to have a knack for seeing it everywhere. Now on to our second Deduce episode from Patreon. Happy holidays, everyone.
Can you deduce?
Welcome back to another episode of Deduce. Obviously, a lot of echo and reverb on that.
Yeah, obviously.
Today, I'll be telling you four news stories. Stories of true crime, bizarre ailments, a black widow, and false teeth. Some of the stories may be true. Some may be outright false. It will be up to you to deduce the truth. Will I be able to trick you into believing a fairy tale? Or will your powers of deduction prevail? Let's get to it.
Deduce.
Our first story is called Leapin' Lizard. One of the best parts of travel is exposure to the local wildlife. I, for one, am drawn to certain locations based solely on the sharks I can dive with. My dream vacation is to visit South Africa to go on a safari and a great white dive so I can see the world's most majestic beasts in person. For 4-year-old Lena, the wildlife she encountered on a family vacation nearly took her life. In August of last year, Lena Mars showed her parents, Julian and Louisa, a small bump about the size of a dime on the back of her left hand atop the middle finger. Even though Lena said the bump didn't hurt and she wasn't feeling sick, her parents decided to take her to the doctor. All the pediatrician could come up with was that the spot was most likely a cyst. There wasn't much that could be done with it, so he told them to keep an eye on the bump and to look out for possible symptoms. They did, and within a few days, the bump started to grow, and it was beginning to cause Lena pain. Ending up at an orthopedist, the doctor decided to conduct a biopsy. Taking the 2-centimeter mass to a lab, it was found Lena was afflicted with Mycobacterium marinum. This infection is common with fish, mostly, who develop a type of tuberculosis illness. When it does appear in humans, which is very, very rarely, it is most often due to someone going into infected waters with an open wound. Armed with the name of the infection, doctors were able to put Lena on a specific type of antibiotic to clear up any rash or infection that remained. But doctors were stumped. How did this toddler end up with not only an illness that's rare in general, but one that is exceptionally rare in humans? It took a few doctor's visits to jog Lena's parents' memories, but eventually, as they discussed her finger injury, it came back to them. They had recalled that back in March, they had gone to Costa Rica for a family vacation. During one of their days relaxing on the beach, Lena was approached by an iguana. Lena stared out at the water, snacking on a piece of cake, as the large lizard came closer and closer. Now, overall, iguanas are very chill, non-human attacking animals that just want to eat berries in trees and fall out of them when they're cold. But in this case, the animal's exposure to humans and their yummy, yummy treats had become a habit, and he needed a fix. The iguana was close enough to Lena that it could bite the back of her hand. That wasn't hard enough to inflict any pain, but it did cause her to drop the cake, which is exactly what the lizard hoped would happen. The iguana grabbed the treat and took off with that funny little leg flappy run they do. Lena showed her parents the bite mark. She seemed okay, but they still took her to the local clinic to get it cleaned and to put her on antibiotics. Within just 2 weeks, the mark was healed and she seemed fine. It wouldn't be until all those months later that the injury and infection would resurface, leading to the surgery. Being that this is the first documented case of a human getting this infection from an iguana, Lena's story is now being shared at medical symposiums around the world. Lena is doing well and is close to 100% recovered. So, is this story of a cake-stealing, infection-spreading iguana true, or is telling a lie like a piece of cake?
Well, the marinara had me wondering if maybe it wasn't true. But I do know that that is a real bacterium. So I'm going to go with true.
Interesting. Josh?
I have a feeling it might be false because there's something that is like hitting my brain. I don't know what it is, but some detail of that story reminded me of something and I don't know what.
Was it a news story, maybe?
Maybe, yes. Yeah, it might be. I'm going to say false.
Interesting. Okay, another divide like last time.
Mm-hmm. I like it when we're on opposite ends of the spectrum.
That's right.
Rum.
Next, we have the story of how gangsters' battles for revenge led to a life-saving tool in Annie, Get Your Gun. Chicago in the early 1920s was a playground for the mob. At the helm was none other than Al Capone. The gangster has had many effects on pop culture, as he was incredibly famous during his rule. The look of pinstripes and fedoras being the go-to for gangsters is thanks to him. He was mentioned in The Godfather. He appeared in Tintin comic books. He was the inspiration for the book and film Scarface. He's been portrayed on screen by Robert De Niro, Eric Roberts, William Forsythe, Tom Hardy, and, of course, a variation by Al Pacino. He's been referenced in songs by Queen, The Specials, Prodigy, and LL Cool J. There are countless books, movies, songs, art pieces, and more dedicated to the mysterious man who would eventually die at his Miami home after serving over 7 years in prison and then being released to a hospital for his severe syphilis.
Did you go to lyrics.com for all that info? like my last case.
No, I think it was Wikipedia had like a list at the bottom.
Did you know that Al Capone, when he was like, retired because of his mental abilities were failing from the syphilis, that his bodyguards would watch him sometimes go fishing in his pool in the backyard?
That's true.
Yep.
Wasn't that the inspiration for Tony on The Sopranos with like the ducks?
Oh, with the ducks?
Oh, probably.
Yeah.
That makes a lot of sense.
I feel like I had heard that before.
That's cool.
Yeah, syphilis is not good. Get tested, people.
It'll eat your brain.
It's a silent killer.
Oof. Before and between his time in Alcatraz, Cook County Jail, and the Atlanta Penitentiary, Al was doing bad things. Being a mob boss came with a high price and a lot of enemies. One of said enemies was Michael Giordano. Michael wasn't a big boss. He actually wasn't any kind of boss, or at least not one that was acknowledged by Capone and his cronies. But Michael didn't care. He wanted a piece of Capone's pie. Michael had been part of the Northside Gang, a rival of the Chicago outfit, which was ruled by Capone. After the St. Valentine's Day massacre, in which 7 members of the NSG were shot and killed in 1929, rumors swirled as to who had been responsible. Maybe vengeful cops, maybe the Egan rats, but Michael was certain it had been Capone.
What's an Egan rat?
That was another cool group of guys.
Ooh, let's make up our cool group.
I wonder, was
the gangbangers.
Is Egan, Egan Illinois? Is that like Egan, Illinois?
Oh, probably.
Yeah, I think so.
Okay.
That's good deduction.
I said gangbangers the other day, and Chloe gasped because I think she just learned like a gangbang is maybe at school.
And you're like, oh, we're so far past that being that.
But I was talking about literal gangbangers in a gang. Like,
oh, yeah. Oh, my God. That's funny. I haven't heard that. That's like real late 90s stuff.
I know.
Look at his pants. He's a real gangbanger.
That's what I said. I was joking. And she like, how dare you talk like that,
Oh,
Mom?
My gosh. That's funny.
And then I just laughed. I'm like, you just don't get it.
Yeah. Call me when you're older. In an attempt to make a name for himself and to show the bosses who would make a great boss, Michael made a move of his own. While this idea was incredibly stupid, he knew to not swing too hard. He certainly wasn't going to take aim at Capone, so he looked further down the ladder. Michael then landed on Frank Nitti, Capone's bestie and fellow tax evader. In the future, Nitti would take over for the outfit when he was only sent to prison for just over a year, compared to Capone's 11-year sentence. But in 1930, they hadn't yet been convicted, and Michael was on a warpath. Knowing the power Nitti had, Michael wasn't planning on messing with him directly, so he took aim, literally, at his wife, Rosa Levitt. On January 22nd, just shy of a year after the Valentine's massacre, Michael stalked Rosa as she was walking home through Chicago around 11:30 p.m. Right outside the house she shared with Frank, she was gunned down. Hearing the commotion, Frank ran outside, pistol in hand. Not finding a fellow gangster in some sort of shootout, he was shocked to see his beloved wife lying on the ground, bleeding to death. Frank was torn between helping Rosa or finding her killer while they were close. Neither choice mattered. There was nothing that could be done to help her, and there was no car or killer in sight. As it always seems to be with the mob or any situation where not overly emotional and reactive men are in charge, it was now Frank who was hellbent on revenge. Proud of his work and hoping it would earn him a higher place in the North Side, Michael wasn't exactly quiet about what he had done. This hadn't been the smartest move on his part. Even if the gangs weren't getting along, they knew better than to mess with the loved one of a very made man. Word quickly got to Frank that it had been Michael who killed Rosa. Michael's pitiful standing in the North Side had Frank reassessing the situation. This had been a personal attack. It wasn't worth getting the North Side and the outfit into a war. He wanted to take things into his own hands and pay Michael back, eye for an eye. Michael also had a lover, Annie Tutasori. They hadn't married yet, but they were planning to and were already living together in sin in a North Side apartment.
Yes.
You know how those Catholics are. With the lightest twist of a few arms, Frank had Michael's address. That Wednesday, March 9th, was cold and dark. It was around 8:30 p.m., and Frank was at a meeting with the gang, and Annie, as Michael called her, was home alone. As she sat in the bed reading a book, she heard an explosion of sounds coming from the living room. A window in their fourth-story apartment, the one that faced the fire escape and alleyway, had been smashed. Leaving the bedroom to examine the situation, she was shocked to see a man climbing in the window from the fire escape. It was Frank. Annie hadn't been privy to the murder of Rosa or the actions of her betrothed, so she never knew she had been in such danger. After locking eyes, Frank fired a shot at Annie. It caught her arm, spewing blood across the carpet. Terrified, she ran for cover, winding up under the dining table. Frank was quick to catch up, flipping the table away. Running back to the bedroom, Frank fired again. Annie was struck and in bad shape. Crawling closer to the room, seeking safety from the door, it was too late. Frank walked up to her, saying, "This is for Rosa," before shooting Annie once again, leaving her dead. Approximately 3 hours later, at almost midnight, Michael returned to his home. Opening the door, the broken glass of the window and flip table were first to catch his attention. Approaching the scene, the pool of blood on the carpet had him screaming out for Annie. Racing through the apartment, he eventually found her in the bedroom. He was too late. She had met her doom at the hand of a mobster, and like with Rosa, nothing could be done. Michael didn't care about getting into any trouble. He just wanted to help Annie, so he called the medics. One of the medics, James Elam, had been developing his own life-saving technique and saw this setting as a perfect place to show his partners what he had been working on. It was clear Annie was gone, but she wasn't officially pronounced dead yet. James wanted to see if his theory worked, and he felt this was a perfect opportunity to show his co-workers the technique. So before they loaded her on the gurney, he asked if she was okay, took her pulse, tilted her head, and attempted an early version of chest compressions. It was clear they weren't going to be of any use, but he knew it was good to practice. Unbeknownst to his fellow medics, James had built a prototype of what would eventually be known as a CPR doll, but he was struggling with one final detail, the face. Knowing how strong and brave the men in the field were, he understood they would be less inclined to breathe into the mouth of a male dummy, so he needed to find a delicate female face that welcomed their attempts to save its life. Although Annie had perished in a terrifying manner, her face after death seemed peaceful to James, and being that this was nearly 100 years ago and rules were a bit loosey-goosey, he asked the mortician, Dr. Paul Woodard, to make what is known as a death mask of Annie. Using plaster of Paris, he was able to do just that, and he gave it to James. James then used the mask as a mold to make for the face for his doll. With the help of toy maker Asmund Ladderall and Dr. Peter Safar, James was able to perfect his doll, which he named Resuscitation Annie, in honor of the woman whose death had inspired him to finish the work. While there is no way to know how many lives have been saved by his groundbreaking technique, it is believed that if everyone was trained in CPR and had practiced breathing into Annie's mouth, 100,000 to 200,000 lives could be saved annually. Frank would go on to be arrested for tax fraud along with his buddy Al Capone. It was documented that Michael was quite distraught after Annie's murder. He fell into alcohol addiction and started to berate his fellow gangsters. His last documented sighting was in June 1931. He may have left the scene on his own, but it's more likely Capone or even his own North Siders were wanting him to go on a swim in some concrete shoes. So, is this tale of gangster love and loss leading to the design of a life-saving device true, or am I masking the real story?
I think it's fake.
I do too.
Because I believe Rescue Anne was created by a foreigner.
You mean the name Asmund Ladrall was not enough of a foreign name for
but
you.
But I'm pretty sure it was too, like, was it Norwegian or too doctor? I think you're using real stuff to make it sound legit.
Yeah, I'm going to say false. I do not want to reveal why I think it's false.
Okay.
Because I don't want
Em
to change her vote.
Okay.
She can. It's fine. But I don't want to.
You don't want to.
I don't
want
to mess
with
anything.
What do you mean? I said false too.
Oh, no. But he's saying that he feels like he knows something the way you know something.
Oh, okay. Cool.
And he doesn't want it to.
Got
okay.
I don't think it wouldn't change your vote. I'm an
interesting
idiot,
that you little fools are thinking.
But it might.
Weird.
Yeah. Because I want you to doubt your vote. And now I probably ruined that.
It's still fun.
Proceed.
It's the time of year where everyone is looking to revamp their eating habits. And whether you're looking to cook more at home or branch out and eat healthier, we have the perfect solution. HelloFresh. With HelloFresh, you get farm-fresh, pre-portioned ingredients and seasonal recipes delivered right to your doorstep. Skip trips to the grocery store and count on HelloFresh to make home cooking easy, fun, and affordable. That's why it is America's number one meal kit. Whether your New Year's resolution is to save money, eat better, or stress less, HelloFresh is here to help you do all three. Say hello to your most delicious year yet with fresh ingredients and chef-crafted recipes at a price you'll like, delivered right to your door. I love HelloFresh because they made it so easy to make a delicious home-cooked meal. I don't have to go to the store or worry about food waste. They also have a great menu selection with options for folks who are watching their calories, looking for something family-friendly, or doing the veggie-only thing. And if you need a good deal to get you to try something new, go to HelloFresh.com/rainfree and use code RAINFREE for free breakfast for life. One breakfast item per box while subscription is active. That's free breakfast for life at HelloFresh.com/rainfree using code RAINFREE. HelloFresh, America's number one meal kit. The holiday season is known for two things, merriment and stress. Get the kids covered for their days off of school. Get them to their holiday parties or performances. Get presents for your loved ones. Get the decorations up. Pick up groceries, traffic, dinners, work, life. It can be a lot. A natural option for relieving stress, anxiety, restlessness, and other sleep-related symptoms is CBD. Yet not all CBDs are equal or work the same. Because of testing, quality, and efficiency, my new go-to CBD is Next Evo. I've used a lot of different brands and forms of CBD, and nothing has tasted as good, worked as well, or had such a positive effect on my stress and anxiety than Next Evo. If my day starts with feelings of anxiousness or stress, I enjoy 3 Next Evo gelatin-free stress complex gummies. Soon after, I feel like a weight has been lifted. I'm not impaired in any way, it's just that that little voice of anxiety has chilled out. Next Evo tests their products, unlike so many other CBD brands, so you'll actually get an accurate dose. My favorite part about Next Evo, besides how well it works and how good I feel, is the variety of options. Need help in the sleep department? Try their sleep support complex. Need something while on the go? Use one of the tiny CBD powder packs that fit discreetly in your purse or pocket and are perfect for those times when you need a little relief in your day. I took one just last week once I realized I was going to be stuck in traffic. It made the ride home much less stressful. Sleep better and calm your stress. Upgrade to better natural solutions from Next Evo Naturals. Go to nextevo.com and use the promo code RAIN for 25% off. That is 25% off at nextevo.com using the promo code RAIN. Next Evo. Join the evolution.
Factor, America's number one ready-to-eat meal delivery service, can help you eat well for breakfast, lunch, and dinner with chef-prepared, dietitian-approved, ready-to-eat meals delivered straight to your door. You'll save time and stay on track with your healthy lifestyle while tackling all of your holiday to-dos. Healthy, ready-made meals does not mean lack of choice and restriction during the holidays. Treat yourself to high-quality, delicious meals by choosing from over 35 chef-created meals every week. Factor meals are also jam-packed with flavor, so you won't miss out. Try delicious, dietitian-approved calorie smart meals with around or less than 550 calories per serving. Or if you need an extra boost to support your wellness goals and feel your best during the holidays, you can try Protein Plus meals with 30 grams of protein or more per serving. This December, get Factor and enjoy eating well without the hassle. Simply choose your meals and enjoy fresh, flavor-packed meals delivered to your door, ready in just 2 minutes, no prep and no mess. Head to factormeals.com/rain50 and use code RAIN50 to get 50% off. That's code RAIN50 at factormeals.com/RAIN50 to get 50% off.
From a young age, Jill Coit, maiden name Billet, always did things her own way. Jill was born in Louisiana in June of either 1943 or 44. Those multiple years aren't due to my lack of research, but due to the fact that Jill liked to lie about everything. Jill's childhood was fairly uneventful. She wasn't a sick kid, no major traumas, although her little brother Mark was born around the time she was six, and Jill always resented him. So maybe his existence alone pushed her into the direction of narcissism, sociopathy, and pathological lying. When Jill was just 17 years old, she met and fell in love with Larry Ihan. Wanting to marry the bricklayer from Indiana, she dropped out of high school. The pair married in the summer of 61. One of the many problems with marrying a teenager is that you are then married to a teenager. So less than a year after saying I do, Jill was saying, I want a divorce and while we're at it, I'm going to take the $280 out of our shared account, hubby. 3 years later, Jill met Stephen Moore. Now 21, Jill married an age-appropriate college student. Pregnant just a few months into their marriage, she gave birth to their son Stephen, I would assume Junior, in 1965. Then in January of 66, when she was 22 years old and the mother of a young son, she married William Coit Jr., an engineer in Texas. What's that? Did I forget to mention Jill's divorce from Stephen? Well, so did Jill. That's because she was still married to him, and she continued to be when she gave birth to baby boy number two, William Andrew Coit, in 1966. Be it because of the illegal nature of bigamy or because her second husband wanted to be in first place, Jill finally divorced Stephen in 1967. A year later, son number three, William Clark Coit III. What's that? Did you think I misspoke because two of her three sons have the same name? Well, I didn't. They're both William. And so far, all of her children have been named after the father. Jill went through life fairly quietly for the rest of the 60s and the start of the 70s. She and third husband William were raising their two Williams and a Stephen in Houston. That is until March 28, 1972. As the senior William was going to bed, the front door was kicked in and he was shot twice in the back, once in the arm and once in the head. Sadly, his killer was never captured. As with any case when a spouse is shot in the back, Jill was looked at as a possible suspect. It didn't help her image that just 20 days prior, she had filed for divorce. William had claimed the divorce had been her way of trying to get her hands on his money. It also didn't help that right after the shooting, Jill left for New Orleans. Lucky for her, she had a great lawyer in Louis DeRosa. He was able to work his magic, and like Emily's story, he kept her from being questioned. He did this by talking her into institutionalizing herself, avoiding extradition to Houston.
Oh my God,
what a weird double from Shooping the Poop. Fun life hack if ever you're being hunted by money sharks or whatever they're called,
loan sharks,
or you're wanted for murder or anything like that. You can apparently just go get hospitalized.
But check your state laws.
Officials attempted to get a hearing with a grand jury where they would have had Jill testify, but that never came to fruition. The case went cold and no one seemed to care about seeking justice since it seemed pretty clear who had been to blame. To avoid any more legal issues, at least with William, Jill went to California where she didn't marry Bruce Johansson. Bruce, the wealthy retired businessman in his 90s, went instead the route of adoption. Lawyer Louis DeRosa came to her rescue again, facilitating the adoption. He also helped with the settlement of the estate when Bruce died a year later, through which Jill was awarded some property and cash. In November 1973, Jill married her fourth husband, Donald Brody. He was from Orange, California, where he was a major in the Marines. The love didn't last long with Donald, and just a year and a half later, the couple split. She didn't stay single for long, of course. This time she picked her husband from the list of men she already knew, marrying the man who had kept her from being looked at as the killer of her husband, the now judge, Louis DeRosa, who was in Mississippi.
I saw that coming.
They would go on to divorce and marry twice.
What?
2 years after marrying lawyer Louis, Jill fell in love with Eldon Metzer, an auctioneer in Ohio. Oops. She again forgot to get divorced. She eventually chose Eldon over Louis, who she divorced in 1978.
Is there a cap on the number of marriages you can have?
Apparently not. Somewhere along the line, the couple ended up in Haiti. Unfortunately, processing a divorce there didn't actually work as it wasn't recognized as being legal in the U.S. And I also don't know where she's getting all this money to travel, like, across the country and down to Haiti and, well, I guess from these guys. At some point, she did get a divorce from Eldon. Still married to Louis, she moved to number 7, Carl Steely, a teacher in Indiana. Something we can deduce from this story is that Jill wasn't the best at making decisions. Finally, back stateside, she was able to legally divorce Louis in New Orleans for a second time. The marriage to Carl was one of her longer relationships, and they stayed married for 9 years, although they were only together for about 7 of them. At the time she left him, she took with her his furniture, a family inheritance, and money from his bank accounts. He would later say that there was an instance in which he was out riding his bike and a car attempted to hit him. He knew that it was Jill, or someone hired by her, attempting to kill him. Before they had officially broken up, Jill and Carl took a vacation to Steamboat Springs, Colorado, where Carl was hoping to retire. While there, Jill purchased a bed and breakfast property. Doing renovations on her new business, she met Gerald Boggs, the owner of a local hardware store. Meeting Gerald was the end of her relationship with Carl, and they divorced. She and Gerald married. Sadly, just 8 months later, the whole not divorcing Carl issue snuck up on her, and the marriage with Gerald was annulled at his behest. The couple had put both of their names on the bed and breakfast, so as part of the split, Jill sued Gerald for the $100,000 deed. The Reporter Times article about this case said that the case file, because of the constant bickering, was a foot thick.
Whoa.
That's a lot of paperwork. Now 48 years old, Jill legally divorced Carl. Thank goodness she did. No, not so she could go back to Gerald, but so she could marry Michael Backus, a phone repairman. Of all things, there isn't proof of them getting hitched, but it was rumored to have happened. Legally married or not, she started to go by Jill Backus. At some point, Jill left Michael in Colorado and went to Texas. The distance, though, wasn't due to her casually leaving another lover in the dust. In Michael Backus, Jill had found more than just another lover. He was someone that was happy to work in cahoots with her to see her malicious plans through. That's why they didn't just settle into their marriage, real or sham, to live a quiet life. Instead, Jill met Roy Carroll in Houston, and soon after, the pair wed in Las Vegas. Sticking to her type of military men, Roy was a U.S. Navy chief petty officer. Everything changed for Jill on October 21, 1993. Gerald Boggs, husband number 9, was discovered dead on his kitchen floor by his brother. Gerald had been clubbed with a shovel, tased, and shot 3 times in the chest. Given her history, it didn't matter that the couple was divorced. Police looked at Jill as a suspect. Doing so, they learned that she had called one of her sons on the day Gerald was murdered, saying, quote, "Hey, baby, it's over and it's messy." When questioned, Jill claimed to have been camping in the Fort Collins area with Michael Backus, not husband Roy, during the murder. Without a time of death, the camping alibi didn't really matter, so investigators got to work. Gerald had last been seen by relatives the day before, but he had been out and about that morning when he went to The Shack, the restaurant he went to every morning for the same meal, eggs, hash browns, toast, and coffee. During the autopsy, remains of hash browns were found in Gerald's stomach, telling officials he had died just a few hours before being discovered. This was a problem for Jill. Her alibi was focused on the time she assumed the investigators would have assumed he had died, which was the night before. As for the morning when he was actually killed, she and Michael didn't really have alibis. Because of that, search warrants were issued for Jill and Michael's personal properties. In Jill's car, a taser was found with prongs that matched up to the marks on Gerald. This was just one of many pieces of evidence. Digging deeper, it was learned Michael had asked at least one coworker if they would be interested in killing Gerald. They weren't, but they also didn't report the question until they were interviewed. It was also found that, unbelievably, Jill somehow convinced people she was a psychologist and she was even treating patients. During one counseling session, she made a proposition to a patient. Thankfully, the woman also refused, but again, she did not report it. In one more disgusting act, Jill asked her own son if he would murder Gerald. He said no. She then asked if he would help her. He said no. She then asked if he would help dispose of the body if she left it outside for him. He said no. Not wanting to turn in his mother, he simply told her that if she was going to do something stupid, she should wear gloves. Side note, hey, guys, if someone asks you if you would be interested in being hired to kill someone, they're probably looking for someone to kill someone, so you could, like, report that. It's okay to do. You might be saving someone's life, okay?
And I don't want to get my mommy mad at me.
Oh, God. The patient. Can you imagine your psychologist? You think you're visiting your psychologist, and they're like, do you want to make some money?
Isn't there a show out right now?
Well, there's the patient, but that's very different. In just a month, the lovebirds from hell were arrested for the first-degree murder of Gerald Boggs. In May of 1995, Michael Backus was sentenced to a mandatory life term without parole, plus 48 years for conspiracy. Jill was also sentenced to life without parole and 48 years. She and Michael were both ordered to pay a fine of $1 million. This wasn't for reparations, but to keep either of them from making money off of their story. So if she had sold her bizarre tale for a book or movie, the money would go straight to the fine, not her pockets. The judge knew she was no good and wanted to do what he could to keep her from victimizing even more people. So why of all the husbands did Jill want Gerald dead, while also keeping in mind she probably did shoot William? This was because Gerald never gave Jill the deed to the bed and breakfast. The murder occurred the day before a trial regarding a lawsuit that Gerald had brought accusing Jill of fraud and bigamy was set to begin. This was why the pair made their way into the home the morning on the 21st, where they ambushed, tortured, and killed him. Jill would, of course, appeal her sentences. She lost. In the late 90s, it was clear she had not learned any kind of lesson and that her evil was insidious. With access to the newfangled internet, she posted on a date a prisoner site and said she was hoping to find a husband.
Of course.
The site was eventually taken down by the state of Colorado. I'm not sure if the entire site itself was removed or if it was just her page. This, of course, did not stop her. In 1998, she had her own page on another inmate site which said, "Want U.S. citizenship? Marry an inmate."
Oh, boy.
Other appeals and motions would come and go, all being denied. In 2002, she filed a request for an investigation into her treatment while in prison for murder. She complained she had not been given her therapeutic back and wrist braces because, of course, she needed those. And on a more serious note, she did claim that she had a finger broken by a guard and that she had been sexually abused. It's unclear what the outcome of that request was, but given her history, I would assume it was denied. It is reported she continues to seek another husband. The only good thing about that is that at least she won't be able to kill the guy. He can Google her and then make his own financial decisions. What's most amazing about this case is that it all came down to hash browns. If Gerald didn't get the same meal every day, and if that time of death had been any earlier or later, it could have been very possible that Jill could have just done what she always did, gotten away with murder. Instead, those shredded potatoes were the key to breaking the case and solving his murder. So, is Jill a real black widow out to marry and kill as she pleases, or is this a lie that should be hashed out?
This one's hard. I'm going to go with false.
Mm.
I don't really have a reason. I'm just going with my gut here.
You know, I don't either, but I'm going to say true.
Oh, the thrill.
There were just so many details and hash browns.
There were a lot of details. Mm.
I love hash browns.
By the way, I Googled just now. The person with the most marriages is a man named Glenn Wolf, and he was married 31 times, and only one of them was annulled.
Did they all last just like a year?
Let's see. 26, 28, 31, 32, 32, 35, 36, 36, 39, 40, 46, 48, 49, 48.
You sound like an auctioneer.
54, 55, 58, 58, 60.
And you have to meet the people.
64, 68, 69, 70, 77, 79, 79, 82, 84, 95, 96. 96.
That's wild.
What is happening?
That's all the years he was married. Every year that he had a marriage. That's why, because you have to meet people and like fall in love and then decide to get married and then plan some sort of something.
Isn't that crazy?
And also when you're, by the time you're at like 17 and you're like, you'll be lucky number 18.
And two of his wives? Oh, that one's the same one. Okay,
oh, yeah.
So one of them's the same one.
Yeah, I bet
Goodwin,
there's more than one.
Back to backs. This is so interesting.
Wow.
I had to know like who has had the most marriages. So I just Googled it.
Is he okay? Let me talk to him about what is up. All right, here's our last story. It's called A Toothy Falsehood. Well, speaking of what we were just talking about, there have been a lot of conversations surrounding technology recently. Smartphones are old news. Now we're occupied by the idea of AI replacing all of our jobs and writing our homework. Another hot topic is self-driving cars. Don't even get me started on the death machines known as Tesla.
Can't wait to invite you to ride in mine.
Well, for more on why they're so scary, you can watch Hulu's New York Times Presents Season 2, Episode 1. I mean, I know New York Times is kind of yikes in and of itself, but all of this information was jarring.
What's wrong with New York Times?
Well, you know, they can be.
They've been releasing stuff before they're like really fact checking.
And some like there was a big issue with the Jordan Neely thing. The guy that was murdered on the subway. They've very much presented it like Marine attacks homeless man kind of a thing, you know. Mm-hmm. So they're having some issues. Recently, Ford, another car company created by a maniacal Nazi supporter, announced, or perhaps it was quietly discovered, that they had filed for a very specific patent. Now, all of this part of the story is true. They have big plans for their future self-driving cars. They hope that they will be able to implement the technology to punish the vehicle's owner. If you default on your payments, the car can then be remotely repossessed.
I've read about this.
Okay, so there are pros. You know, if you can't pay for your car and they just want the car back, okay, I get that. You can't just keep your car. And repossession is also very dangerous for both parties. Mm-hmm. So removing the human element will definitely be more safe. Now, cons. First off, excuse you? And what? The thing with technology is that as soon as you think of the supposed good idea, you have to also think of the worst thing that could be done. So, Ford, you're telling us that a disgruntled guy who works at Ford won't then get into the system and have his girlfriend or wife's car, who probably has a restraining order against him, just driven to him or driven to some location?
Or like the kids are in it and it
drives
them
back? Yeah,
like
how can they be sure no one's in the car?
Also, there are clerical errors where somebody actually did pay and there's a mistake. Didn't that happen to a guy with Tesla that the car locked him out?
I think something like that, yeah.
But he's like, I did pay.
Yeah, it's like, so we're going to trust the banks to all work right. We're going to trust people with access to this and not mess with people.
Seems a little dangerous.
I'm not excited about it. So I get it. Ford is a business. They sell you a car. You pay for it. You don't. They take it back. Well, one guy had those same feelings about 100 years ago, but it wasn't about a Ford, but it did involve a grill. On April 13th, 1922, barber John Bush was walking down the street. It was a lovely day, and he was enjoying his stroll through St. Louis. Suddenly, John was attacked. He wasn't hit, but he suddenly felt a hand enter his mouth. Getting his bearings, he looked at his assailant and realized he knew him. It was his dentist, Dr. Frank Passebeck. Pulling his hand away, Frank was now in possession of John's false teeth. John called the police and had Frank arrested. The dentist was then charged with larceny. I'm not sure how an assault charge wasn't involved, but it was the 20s. Things were wild. When interviewed as to why the dentist would rip teeth out of a man's face, the dentist said he had actually made those falsies and John never paid the bill. With John refusing to pay, Frank did the only thing he could. He, quote, took it out of his hide.
He repossessed that mouth.
That's right. So take that, Ford. Sometimes the direct human experience of repossession is needed. Maybe the dramatic interaction caused John to think twice before skipping a bill. Good thing it wasn't the other way around. I would hate to hear of John the barber getting his payment back from a customer. Is this tale of a biting redemption true, or am I lying through my teeth?
Well, based on my previous answers, I'm going with true.
Oh, mixing
it up.
Because
I think you do two and two, but I don't know. That one was short and sweet.
Ooh.
I like the idea of it.
Right?
I mean, real human interaction. That's only the
sometimes
only way to have empathy.
Sometimes you just want a face-to-face encounter.
I'm going true.
Okay. So we got two trues on that. Okay. Let's get to the answers.
Yay.
Okay, leap and lizard. What were your guesses?
I said true.
You said true. Josh, you said false?
I did.
Okay.
Do you want to hear my reasons?
Yes.
Of course we do.
It reminded me of something that we watched where someone got bit or something and they had like eggs in their body or something.
Oh,
like
interesting.
That.
Oh, you were like, that could happen.
It reminds me of that. So
interesting. Okay.
That's why I said false.
All right. Leap and lizard. The story of Lena getting the first ever lizard to human mycobacterium marinara, as I like to say. That is true.
Heck
all
yeah.
of it. She is doing well, but she is, as of April this year, still recovering.
Oh, my gosh.
All right.
Wow.
So did Al Capone's actions lead to the creation of the life-saving recitation Annie?
I said false.
You said false. Josh, you said false as well.
I said false for, can I tell you my reasons?
Sure.
Why do you ask us every time? Yes.
Can
you
I?
Because he's a quiet boy and
you
he needs
tell
permission.
Us, open your mouth and I'll repossess your teeth.
It reminded me of the song Smooth Criminal.
Oh, interesting.
Michael Jackson's Smooth Criminal.
Oh, I've never really listened to it.
Yeah, just bloodstains on the something. Annie. You said okay.
Oh.
Annie, just, are you okay?
And gangsters.
You okay, Annie.
Okay.
So that's why I said
this
crash.
Story is false.
Yeah.
But there are some connections. Here's how I got to talking about the mafia. Before Michael Jackson's album Bad was released, he cut a song which had been called Al Capone.
Oof.
Not good.
Uh-uh.
That song did not end up on the album, but the bones of it were used to create the smash hit Smooth Criminal. Jackson got the idea for Annie, Are You Okay? Are You Okay? Are You Okay, Annie? After learning about the creation of the CPR doll and how that phrase is the first thing you say to the doll while in training. The names of the doctors and toy maker were accurate, but they had used the face of a woman who had drowned in the 1880s. They did choose a woman so that men would be more apt to practice the procedure, but the doll itself was not first presented to the world until 1960. Al Capone and Frank Nitti and Rosa were all real. Rosa was not murdered. Michael did not exist. The guys were involved in those gangs. The Valentine's Day Massacre and the tax evasion were all real. A few months ago, and this all happened, I decided to do this because Josh and I were at a game night and Smooth Criminal came on. And I think we were joking about the words, or I think I even said, like, I should see if this is a real story. And we realized that, like, no one at the table knew the words to the song. Like
I was just thinking, I don't know them.
Anyway, so when I realized that no one knew the lyrics, I was like, oh, well, then that'd be a really fun way to turn the lyrics of that song, the story of that lyric.
That's a good idea.
Into a story. So, oh, thank you.
So I knew, and I knew about the doctors that invented it, and I figured since I hadn't heard about that case, that it you were just like
well,
using real information.
Yeah, so some of the lyrics are, as he came into the window, it was the sound of a crescendo. He came into her apartment. He left the bloodstains on the carpet.
Uh-huh.
She ran underneath the table. He could see she was unable, so she ran into the bedroom. She was struck down. It was her doom. Annie,
wow.
Are you okay? Are you okay, Annie? That's literally all the lyrics. You've been struck by a smooth criminal. Well, thank you. Okay, next we have Hash It Out, the story of multiple husband having Jill Coit. Was this true or false?
I said false, but I really had no reason to. I just was making a choice.
Okay.
I said true because of the stomach content information, stomach contents.
Which that, I love that little detail.
Yeah, it was good. And I love hash browns.
Me too.
That story was true.
Oh,
every last
my first wrong
wow.
answer.
Oh, every last bit of it. She has exhausted all of her appeals, but she is going to be spending the rest of her life in the Denver Women's Correctional Facility.
Well, shit, does that mean I got my last one wrong, too? I hate being wrong.
And I think I didn't watch it because I didn't want to tweak how I was saying it, but I do believe there is a forensic files at the very least on her story and on the stomach contents.
Maybe that's why it's familiar to me.
Oh, probably. I'm sure you've seen it. Yeah. You're a real forensic file boy.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, finally, toothy falsehood. Did John get his teeth repossessed by his dentist?
I gotta say true.
You said true.
I said true.
What year was this?
1920s.
Yes.
1922.
True.
All of this story, including the Ford repossession plan, is true.
Nice. Yeah. I only got one wrong.
I could not find an outcome regarding Frank's legal issues, but I'm sure everything ended up being squared away. And I hope John got some replacement teeth and paid for them.
Wow. I love it. This is so fun.
It is the most fun.
Can't wait till episode 3.
So that had two truths and one false. So we'll see for next time.
Wait.
Wait, what? No, it had.
All right, that's only three.
Okay.
It had three
it
truths.
It had three truths
and one
false. Don't make me do math.
You guys made up the story yourselves.
Deduce my math.
Can you deduce the true number of what I'm saying? Because I cannot. I don't do math. I'm bad at number time.
Time for lunch.
Uh-huh. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye.
One of the best parts of traveling is exposure to the local wildlife. For 4-year-old Lena, the wildlife she encountered...
I encountered it too.
...with Mycobacterium marinarum. This infection is common in fish, mostly.
Oh, you said marinarum earlier? Marinara sauce. Marinum.
Ha ha.
I'm sorry.
Everyone, it's a shock. She can't read.
This is not true.
She can't read. That's so shocking. I can't even believe that she can't say words right or read. This is new and weird.
Marinarum.
Well, y'all are making me try to say these hard ass words that might be real or fake.
You inflicted it on yourself.
I know. One of said enemies was Michael Giordano. Yeah, Giordano. Okay.
Michael Giordano.
Giordano, thank you.
I want some.
Ooh, DiGiorno's. Yeah. DiGiorno's croissant crust.
I haven't tried that. Is it good?
It's so good.
I'm hungry.
Layers.
I'm going to need
flaky.
A lunch soon.
I'm going to need a lunch. A marinarum.
Mm-hmm. We can order some lunch while we print for our photos.
Marinarum.
All right. All right. Compared to Capone.
I want a calzone real bad.
I know, right? Ooh, some mozzarella.
I'm so hungry. What
On January 22nd, hello?
The internet didn't tell me that was a thing.
Help
so
me, internet.
I'll
fix
figure
me
it out this week. I'll ask ChatGPT,
oh,
my
God,
new best friend.
Please stop promoting it.
I can't help it. It's so convenient. I've used it so much this week.
For work?
Yeah, just like writing emails.
Oh, my God.
Or I went because I countered my offer for my new job.
And then you're going to get fired and not get paid any money because robots are cheaper.
There are certain jobs you cannot do with the robot.
I need my Bic Atlantis.
Oh, yes.
Oh, I'm sorry. This is a Sharpie S gel, and it is my favorite.
Oh, those are my fave. I have a bunch of them.
The best pen I've ever used in my life.
Oh, my God.
Besides a Bic Atlantis.
Do you remember, like, the first year we were doing this, you and I bonded over a pen we both had and loved?
Yes.
It was the Bic Atlantis. I do remember that.
And then now we both have another new pen
wild.
We love?
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
We are siblings, I think, in a weird way.
Never know with Keith Rowney.
Oh, my God.
He asked the mortician.
You could say mortish.
I mean, I did say mortish.
Yeah.
Deduce.